Good morning, everybody. Sorry for the late start, but we are gathered virtually as a community of faith and are spanning wider territory this morning. And we're glad to have Blanca from Nova Scotia. We are sorry for what Nova Scotia is experiencing. It has been a difficult year there, difficult spring and summer, and you're just getting into hurricane season. So we pray that it might be milder. And certainly hearing stories of all the great white sharks that are gathering around Nova Scotia these days. So it's interesting times. But we're glad to have everyone here, and we're glad to be able to worship together as Mountainside United Church Community of Faith. McGill University is on land which has long served as a site of meeting and exchange amongst Indigenous peoples, including the Anishinaabeg, the Ganiyangahaga Nations. And we acknowledge and thank the diverse Indigenous peoples whose presence marks this territory on which the peoples of the world now gather. The grace of our sovereign Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
The wonderful thing about being with this, one of the wonderful things about being with this community of faith is the breadth of music we can, I can play around with and use from our hymn resources within the United Church and new ones coming in. This might be a newer one for some of you. Unbound Spirit, Breath of God, from More Voices 155.
Unbounded Spirit, Breath of God,
From the resource from the United Church of Canada for Emancipation Day celebrations. May we pray. God of all people, we come acknowledging you in all your majesty and glory.
We thank you that as with Black people, we share with all humanity your divine grace and favor.
Help us in our worship to lift to you all of creation in its beauty and splendor.
Help us in our worship to remember the struggles and pain of our ancestors who worked for freedom and those who could only dream of that day.
Help us to journey with pride strengthened by those whose struggles and sacrifice have paved the way of liberty for us.
Help us in our reflections to recommit to seeking justice and liberty for ourselves, for all who are devalued, exploited, and oppressed.
To you be all honor and glory today and always.
God, hear the silent opening of our hearts to those things that lie deep within us this day.
God, in your love,
hear our prayer.
Amen. Sing your praise to God eternal from Voices United, number 244.
Praise to God the Spirit, living.
Perhaps this is one of the greatest texts we approach with reverence, and disturbing in its own right. It is a story of transformation. It is a story of wrestling with God. It is a story of the foundation of the Judeo-Christian tradition. Hear this reading from the Book of Beginnings, the 32nd chapter, verses 20 to 31. For Jacob thought, I will appease him with the present that goes ahead of me. And afterwards I shall see his face. Perhaps he will accept me. So the present passed on ahead of him, and he himself spent that night in the camp. That the same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket. And Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Penuel, limping because of his hip. This is the witness of your people Israel.
Thanks be to God.
Today we're reading Psalm 119 from Voices United, page 838 and 9. And it is with a refrain. How shall the young be faultless in their way? By keeping to your words.
With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not stray from your commandments.
I treasure your word in my heart, for fear I should sin against you.
Blessed are you, O God. Teach me your statutes.
With my lips I proclaim all the judgments you have uttered.
I find more joy in the way of your commandments than in all manner of riches.
I will delight in your statutes. I will give heed to your ways.
I will meditate on your precepts. I will not forget your word.
The gospel today is taken from Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. Now, when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Write these words on our hearts, dear God.
Spirit of the Living God, from Voices United, number 376. You don't stop the rock. Rock. Jacob dreams of a stairway to heaven on a rock. Rocks are used to put early Christians to death by someone who later becomes a Christian. Rock is the image of a quavering disciple who assumes leadership. Rock its way through the stories of the Testaments, and there are many more. But this morning's reading focuses on Jacob's painful transformation into Israel, and the image of him limping for the rest of his life. Powerful. I don't know if any of you caught on CBC yesterday, the CBC production from Stratford of Richard III with the parking lot king, whose remains were found under. And it starts with that investigation. And up from the grave rises Combe Fiore as the Duke of Gloucester, limping. And there's parallels between that character of Richard III, who, because of his deformity, starts to have, use whatever ways, the Machiavellian character of the Elizabethan age. And this character, Jacob, you can say Israel, the founder of the faith, the tribes, the history, the name used to this date. And yet, in the biblical writings, when you read about him, not, he's kind of a Richard III character in many, many ways. It's been highlighted that he was an opportunist, a co-conspirator, shifty, untrustworthy, negligent, and a father who picked favorites. Not somebody you choose to head a corporation, a people, a community of faith necessarily. But as the theologian Martin Luther once said, God can ride even the lame horse. A kingdom for the horse. God can ride even a lame horse. So it's important to acknowledge that founding fact about communities of faith. They are not perfect, nor do they have to be perfect. And the greatest danger is when they think they are heading to perfection. We have stories of early Christian mobs destroying the library and the wisdom therein in Alexandria, the great resource, of tearing, accusing a female professor of being a witch and flaying her to death with pot shards, and then sacking the library out of righteous fervor for a bishop who wanted not just to be spiritual power, but temporal power as well. So it's not a clean, easy history. And that can be problematic to those of this age with a puritanical fervor that wants to be woke and therefore rewrite what was. When you rewrite what was, I don't know that you learn from what was. It doesn't mean it was right. It means that's what was there then. But even within a misguided community of faith at times, when we look back, God could still work God's purposes. And I believe that is something we have to hold on to, that we don't lose sight that then is not now, but then got us to now, and hopefully what will come after now, when we continue to wrestle with God, will be more like a fitting commonwealth for the Holy One to dwell. The next slide. How many of you grew up with both of these? The hymnary of the United Church of Canada, before the new Red Book, the new hymnary, and the struggles about that hymnary, and the accompanying image of a pastoral, blessed, Arian Jesus. I think I've shared that I found most surprising that in the Abyssinian Baptist in Harlem, the great mother church of the Black Church, the stained glass window, Jesus looks not dissimilar to this. I asked some of the professors at Princeton Seminary about that and said, yeah, that's still an issue within the Black church to see Jesus as Black or any other color. And we just learn to accept the pastoral image of the perfect white, gentle Jesus, never saying an angry word, though he did upset a temple. The alter ego to the Jacob, the perfected one. Now, to say God in Christ and God with Christ and through Christ and to worship Christ does not deny that. But where then is the humanity of Jesus? There's a danger of heresy when we forget that Jesus was truly human as well as divine. But the danger is also what was pushed on the world by this image. Growing up, you didn't question it. That was Jesus. Clearly, you could see Jesus. It was in the window of the church. In the Bible, if you look at your 1960s, 50s, and 60s revised standard version of your Bible that you got in Sunday school or confirmation, Jesus would look like that, along with those around Jesus, with maybe one Black person, a child normally. The next slide. And Sunday school looked like this. I remember the stories that we shared and taught. Do you remember the curriculum, the new curriculum, back in the heyday of the United Church? I looked for an image of it and could not find it. If any of you have a copy that I could photograph, I'd love. The People on the Rock. It was the series of Sunday school books for different age levels that you were to teach. I taught Sunday school. Do we have any other Sunday school teachers here? Do any of you remember using that curriculum? As I said, Nandy Johnson, George Johnson's spouse, was one of the writers of that. It was a good curriculum. But again, the imagery were not dissimilar to this, because that's what was known. That was, by and large, except for a few urban centers, the Canada of that time. And the United Church at its peak in the 60s was that kind of community. As adorable as these kids are, including the one leaning who has some personality and wants to ham it up for the camera. I like her. The others are, one little boy in his Gap shirt looks a little scared, but kids are kids and kids are fascinating, but it shows you where we are now. And thank goodness some things that we learned are no longer being learned in the schoolyard, though not always. The next slide. And music followed. On the one hand, you have one of the famous versions of earlier Jacob's dream by William Blake, and this wonderful helix into a golden sun. 1800, this is produced, a little before, a little after, so roughly 1800. This wonderful vibrancy that was Blake, and spiraling up to the firmaments and the Holy One. And then you have the 70s version of that, that anyone who is of my generation or maybe a little younger would know, Led Zeppelin, Stairway to Heaven, British Invasion, rock, rebellious. I don't know if I told some, but at once I did have fairly blondy red hair, and the mustache came because it started off as a beard, but the beard was far, far too fire red. So by the time I went home for Christmas, it was just the mustache, which itself was daring. But to go to church and I had longer hair, and the kids I had taught were very upset because they said Mr. Troop had become a hippie. No. But hey, that was the time. Remember those times, also with the flared, the bell-bottom trousers and those heels? Thank goodness fashion changed. But it was white groups using black music to sell a new idea of music. But its essence was black. But it wouldn't do too well to see black. That just wouldn't be shown at that time. But let's go on to the next slide. In a decade or so after, a change. This is the Sugar Hill Gang, 1979. They're a little late. I'm amazed that hip hop, which is very African American roots, is 50 years old now, this summer, 50 years. I was thinking about trying to rap, but I decided against that because A, I don't know how well I would do it, and is that misappropriation, but a fascinating change in our music. But I bet you everyone here knows the hip hop song. It was just everywhere, so I'd be surprised if you don't. But interesting, the expression here. Something else has changed. For one thing, music is now African. It has that essence of being black and bold and proud. And it's getting into other areas, gangsta. And the image here, kupols. An issue which we discussed at Princeton was that whole difficulty because of the nature of you have to stay cool, you have to be cool. You can't let loose of that. And so the culture, the resistance, and the image of tough guy and gangster and guns and violence and getting what you want and bling, the beginning of bling seen here. It's if we can't have it by peaceful means, we'll take it. The next slide. I said hip hop. The hippie hippie to the hip hop hop, you don't stop the rock. It's a bang bang boogie, sit up, jump the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie beat. Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the groove, and my friends are going to try to move your feet. Sam Wonder Mike, and I'd like to say hello to the black, to the white, the red, and the brown, the purple, and yellow. But first I gotta bang bang the boogie to the boogie to jump step up the boogie to the bang bang boogie. Let's rock, you don't stop. Rock the riddle that'll make your body rock. Remember that? Well, maybe a better approximation of that, but I bet most of you at any wedding party danced to that at that time. And the kids' videos and Sunday school videos and other things else that you've seen around, this became just amazingly popular. But I like the image here. He says he's Wonder Mike is speaking to the whole world, the black, the white, the red, the brown, and hey, purple and yellow if you want as well. And the riddle of the rock. Rock the riddle. And that's what we're looking at this morning in that text of so many centuries ago, of the story of Jacob wrestling and the faith that is founded there and is still continuing and still with its struggles and with its problems is still evolving and emerging. And many are saying, well, it's gone, it's passé, but no, it still keeps to coming on because God can ride even a lame horse. The next slide. And so the image, which I've spoke of before by Gauguin, in the late 19th century. And the division between us contemplating this image and the division that we can't get there, it's in past. And yet we can meditate on it, pray about it, study it, learn it. We are on the side of the possessions of this strange individual. You noticed the list of possessions, and that's what they were. The two wives, you know, and on it goes. Jacob's wealth was in what he owned. And that included people. So we stand there as part of Jacob's legacy, watching this scene, watching that division from afar, and how does that experience of Jacob's struggle enter into our faith struggle these days? And we are in struggling times. I have not seen the like of it since perhaps maybe the early 60s and the riots and the assassinations. The struggle of, well, what is right and where are we called to be, and justice and human rights and human dignity and dignity of women and LGBTQ plus people, and certainly of people of different color, and the white privilege and the struggle to change that. And that whole association of going after Lauren Harris in the Group of Seven because one of Harris's drawings was next to an article by a professor and a white supremacist by the look of things now. And so it's all the same, where I can say at least one member of the group that I knew very well, certainly not the case. But we're struggling. We're trying to find a new way of being, a more just way of being. And I do believe God is involved in that. There's something for that. That Gauguin is a precursor of us, the faith, the fire, the passion of struggling and continuing the struggle. And this, as a community of faith, we are called to do, to continue that struggle, to not think we've solved it, not think we own it, not think we have the control over it, but to acknowledge that there is something larger than us that is moving through us and with us when we do our best to be faithful to a loving God. The next slide. And so we move, and yet don't move. The one shot is of where the United Church was founded, just to the left. That's Metropolitan United Church in Toronto. In a very different looking Toronto, you can see the taller Methodist spire to the Roman Catholic spire that tried, but was not allowed to be taller than the United Church spire. And the arena that was just to its side in 1925, which we're coming up to our centenary shortly. And what was then there, we would not want now. We've known many things since then, including church activities and residential schools. But there are issues that are still here. And to me, the best is this example that we've heard in our news lately that is experienced here in our city, the issue of driving while Black. I still say that is the best slap with wit and intelligence to the racist attitudes of law enforcement or of individuals of cultural identity, even cultures that say, well, we're not racist. Driving while Black is, and it's a play. And you, what I like about that is on the red, look at the W, look closely at the W. You see the eyes in the hood? What's behind it? I think there is great wit and intelligence, something about symbolism and art that brings the message home, that the person of color has to be mindful that while driving, that history is still present. Maybe in 10 years, 20 years from now, the church will find a way to be without that aspect, and our society will wonder what that was. May God continue to struggle with us, and may we realize that if we do struggle with God, we might hippity hop, but you can't stop the rock. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. For more voices, Spirit God, be our breath.
Spirit God, be our breath, be our song. Blow through us, bringing strength to move on. Our world seems in red, defensive, withdrawn. Spirit God, be our song.
Patient God, soothe our pride, calm our fear. Comfort us when we know you are near. We grow more certain, our vision is clear. Patient God, calm our fear.
Loving God, be our voice, be our prayer. Reaching out, joining hands as we share. We seek your guidance through friendship and care. Loving God, be our prayer.
Spirit God, be our breath, be our song. Blow through us, bringing strength to move on. Through change, through challenge, and break the
And so may God continue to bless us. May that face that we can see and live shine upon us, and that countenance be lifted up on us. And may we experience shalom in this world and the next. Amen. Thank you, Blanca, for sharing in the service and reading. Welcome back, Alberto. Glad to have you with us. Glad to have everyone here that have been able to join us in this online service of worship. And it was lovely to hear blended into our current group, Sarah Dufresne. We have to be careful because I suspect her royalties will be going up because she is on stage at the Royal Opera House Covent Garden in this winter this fall season. One of the pieces I know she's singing in is The Marriage of Figaro, but she will be on stage at Covent Garden. So wonderful to follow Sarah and how her career is developing. May God be with you and bless you in this week ahead.